God calls his people to follow Christ and forms us into a royal priesthood, a holy nation, to declare the wonderful deeds of him who has called us out of darkness into his marvellous light. The church is the body of Christ, the people of God, and the dwelling place of the Holy Spirit. In baptism, the whole church is summoned to witness to God's love and to work for the coming of his kingdom. To serve this royal priesthood, God has given particular ministries. Priests are ordained to lead God's people in the offering of praise and the proclamation of the gospel. They share with the bishop in the oversight of the church, delighting in its beauty and rejoicing in its well-being. They are to set the example of the good shepherd always before them as the pattern of their calling. With the bishop and their fellow presbyters, they are to sustain the ministry of the faithful by the community of the faithful, by the ministry of word and sacrament, that we all may grow into the fullness of Christ and be a living sacrifice acceptable to God. Would you please stand, candidates?
Bishop, I present Amy Jane Tabitha to serve in the benefice of Reading Breakfast, Judy Ann Howell to serve in the benefice of Newbury, St George and St John, and Andrew Julian Storch to serve in the benefice of Caversham, Thameside and Maple Durham, all to be ordained to the office of priest in the Church of God.
Have those whose duty it is to know these deacons and examine them found them to be of godly life and sound learning?
They have.
Do they believe them to be duly called to serve God in this ministry?
They do.
Ordinance, do you believe that God is calling you to this ministry?
I do, certainly.
I invite the Archdeacon to confirm that the candidates have taken the necessary oaths and made the declaration assent.
They have duly taken the oath of allegiance to the sovereign and the oath of canonical obedience to the bishop. They have affirmed and declared their belief in the faith which is revealed in the Holy Scriptures and set forth in the Catholic Creeds, and to which the historic formularies of the Church of England bear witness.
Let us pray. God, our Father, Lord of all the world, through your Son you have called us into the fellowship of your universal church. Hear our prayer for your faithful people, that in their vocation and ministry each may be an instrument of your love, and give to your servants now to be ordained the needful gifts of grace, through our Lord and Saviour Jesus Christ, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Let's sit for the readings.
The first reading is from the book of Isaiah, chapter 61. The Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is on me, because the Lord has anointed me to preach good news to the poor. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom for the captives and release for the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn, and provide for those who grieve in Zion, to bestow on them a crown of beauty instead of ashes, the oil of gladness instead of mourning, and a garment of praise instead of a spirit of despair. They will be called oaks of righteousness, a planting of the Lord for the display of his splendor. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
A reading from the first letter of Peter. Come to him, a living stone, though rejected by mortals, yet chosen and precious in God's sight. And like living stones, let yourselves be built into a spiritual house, to be a holy priesthood, to offer spiritual sacrifices, acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. For it stands in Scripture, "See, I am laying in Zion a stone, a cornerstone, chosen and precious, and whoever believes in him will not be put to shame. To you then who believe, he is precious, but for those who do not believe, the stone that the builders rejected has become the very head of the corner, and a stone that makes them stumble, and a rock that makes them fall. They stumble because they disobey the word, as they were destined to do. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's own people, in order that you may proclaim the mighty acts of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John.
Glory to you.
After Jesus had washed their feet, had put on his robe, and had returned to the table, he said to them, "Do you know what I have done for you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for that is what I am. So if I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have set you an example, that you also should do as I have done to you. Very truly I tell you, servants are not greater than their master, nor are messengers greater than the one who sent them. If you know these things, you are blessed if you do them." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Would you please be seated? I'd like to begin, if I may, with a few personal words to those about to be ordained as priests. Let me say this to you. God is in this place, attentive to this moment, and attentive to each one of you. Take a moment to look round and to remember. Allow the sights, the sounds, the experiences of this day to become part of who you are and who you are becoming. Commit to your mind and to your heart and to your soul what is happening here in this moment. God and the church are conferring upon you a responsibility that will be for you at times a great source of joy. And at other times it will lead you into darker valleys. But at all times, remember this moment and remember your calling. So now the sermon. I'd just like to spend a few moments with each of those three readings, and I'd like to invite you to notice the movement within each one.
We begin with the words of the prophet Isaiah, "The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me, he has sent me." The movement in Isaiah is one of sending. It is an outward movement. Isaiah speaks of God's servant announcing their role. The person has been personally chosen and empowered by God for a purpose. And that purpose is to bring God's peace and his saving help. The beautiful words which the prophet speaks are brimming with compassion, with hope, and with purpose. And 700 years after these prophetic words were spoken, Jesus would say today, this scripture, these words from Isaiah 61, as we've got them recorded, have been fulfilled in your hearing. As people called to be Christ-like, so these words also speak to your calling. You are anointed and you are sent to proclaim the good news, to roll up your sleeves, get stuck in, and be good news. Good news to people who are so broken by life that they have no more heart to try. Those who are so bound up in addiction that liberty and release are a cruel mirage. Those who think they will never again experience the favor of the Lord. Those who think their lives hold nothing more than ashes and the fainting heaviness of despair. To them, you are sent to be good news. The movement in Isaiah is one of sending. It is an outward movement. So we come to Peter writing to the churches in Asia Minor near the Black Sea. Who says this? Come to him. Come to him, a living stone. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. The movement in Peter is one of coming back to Christ, of returning. It is an inward movement. Just as we have been sent to minister to the needs of others, so we choose to return and keep returning. Because we are conscious of our own need to receive God's mercy. Cynicism and weariness over a period of years of ministry can diminish our willingness to do this. And so it's so important to keep our hearts supple and responsive to the gentle voice of God's Spirit, which keeps calling us back to be embraced once again by our Heavenly Father. Pope Francis asked these questions. What does mercy mean for you? What place and meaning does mercy have in your heart, in your life, in your personal history, and perhaps also in your future? And he continued with these words of encouragement. Let us be renewed by God's mercy. Let us be loved by Jesus. Let us enable the power of his love to transform our lives too. And let us become agents of that mercy, channels through which God can water the earth, protect all of creation, and makes justice and peace flourish. Insofar as you can, do not tire of returning. The movement in Peter's first letter is one of returning. It is an inward movement. Finally, in our gospel reading, Jesus says this, "For I have set you an example, that you also should do as I have done to you." The setting in which Jesus' followers are gathered in his presence, allowing Jesus to minister to them, offers us an insight into what happens between the sending and the returning, which is the remaining. Between the outward movement of Isaiah and the inward movement of Peter, we find a place of stillness, contemplation, and change. And there for a while, we remain. In the continuing rediscovery of the person of Jesus, we align our wills to his, and we embrace the work of the Holy Spirit. And so there is a change that deepens our faithfulness and releases the creative work of God's kingdom. The process of change enables us to adapt to the new situations that lie before us, and goodness knows, new situations lie before us. And those situations are those in which we must proclaim the gospel. And then, having remained for a time, we must set out once again in order to stay close to God, unafraid, renewing the pattern of our sending, our returning, and our remaining. In this extract from the parson's role today, Monica Furlong expresses something of the power of remaining. And if you haven't read it yet, you should, because it appears at the end of the Diocese Flourishing in Ministry booklet, which I commend to you. Now would be a good time to get a copy if you've not got one. I'm clear what I want of the clergy, she says. I want them to be people who can, by their own happiness and contentment, challenge my ideas about status, about success, about money, and so teach me how to live more independently of such drugs. I want them to be people who are secure enough in the value of what they are doing to have time to face the emptiness and possible depression, which often attack people when they do not keep the surface of their mind occupied. I want them to be people who have faced this kind of loneliness and discovered how fruitful it was, as I want them to be people who have faced the problems of prayer. I want them to be people who can sit still without feeling guilty, and from whom I can learn some kind of tranquility in a society which has almost lost the art. This, by the way, is not a slacker's charter. Okay, do not hear that in my words. Instead, it is the call to be courageous. It invites a countercultural lifestyle which isn't afraid to stop and to look our human condition in the eye without fear or shame, and there to find the transforming place of grace and love which triumphs in the end. Three readings: an outward movement, an inward movement, and remaining, and then repeat. These movements may express themselves in lengthy seasons or in the different hours of a single day. And through them, you will continue to live and to move and to have your being in God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. I'd like to conclude where I started. May the Spirit of the Lord God be upon you, because he's anointed you. And by your life and your ministry, may you display his glory. Amen.
Priests are called to be servants and shepherds among the people to whom they are sent. With their bishop and fellow ministers, they are to proclaim the word of the Lord and to watch for the signs of God's new creation. They are to be messengers, watchmen, and stewards of the Lord. They are to teach and to admonish, to feed and to provide for his family, to search for his children in the wilderness of this world's temptations, and to guide them through its confusion, they may be saved through Christ forever. Formed by the word, they are to call their hearers to repentance and to declare in Christ's name the absolution and forgiveness of their sins. pray and ponder all this, and that you are fully determined, by the grace of God, to devote yourselves wholly to his service, so that as you daily follow the rule and teaching of our Lord, and grow into his likeness, God may sanctify the lives of all with whom you have to do. And now, in order that we may know your mind and purpose, you must make the declarations we put to you. Do you accept the Holy Scriptures as revealing all things necessary for eternal salvation through faith in Jesus Christ?
We do say yes.
Will you be diligent in prayer, in reading Holy Scripture, and in all studies that will deepen your faith and fit you to bear witness to the truth of the gospel? Will you lead Christ's people in proclaiming his glorious gospel, so that the good news of salvation may be heard in every place? Will you faithfully minister the doctrine and sacraments of Christ as the Church of England has received them, so that the people committed to your charge may be defended against error and flourish in faith? Will you, knowing yourself to be reconciled to God in Christ, strive to be an instrument of God's peace in the Church and in the world? Will you endeavour to fashion your own life and that of your household according to the way of Christ, that you may be a pattern and example to Christ's people? Will you work with your fellow servants in the gospel for the sake of the kingdom of God? Will you accept and minister the discipline of this church and respect authority duly exercised within it?
I know.
We
the peace of the whole world, for the welfare of the Holy Church of God, and for the unity of all. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all the members of the Church in their vocation and ministry, that they may serve him in truth and love. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For our bishops, Stephen, Colin, Alan, and Olivia, and for all bishops, presbyters, and deacons, that they may hunger for truth and thirst after righteousness. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For Amy, Julie, and Andy, called to be priests in his church, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the mission of the church, that in faithful witness we may proclaim the gospel of reconciliation to the ends of the earth, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the unity of the church, that we may be one in Christ according to his will, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord,
for those who do not yet believe, that they may receive the light of the gospel, and for those whose faith has grown cold, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the sick and suffering, for the aged and infirm, for the lonely and neglected, and for all who remember and care for them, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the poor and the hungry, for the homeless and the oppressed, for all prisoners and captives, and for our brothers and sisters who are persecuted for their faith, let us pray to the Lord. For Elizabeth, our Queen, for the leaders of the nation, and for all in authority, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For ourselves, for grace to repent and amend our lives, that we may be pardoned and absolved from all our sins, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remembering all who have gone before us in faith, and in communion with Pridewide, Berinus, and all the saints, we commit ourselves, one another, and our whole life to Christ our God.
To you.
Ordain in your name to share as a priest in the ministry of the gospel of Christ. anointed Christ with the Holy Spirit at his baptism. Anoint and empower me to reconcile and bless his people. Send down the Holy Spirit on your servant Julie for the office and work of a priest in your church. God, who anointed the Christ with the Holy Spirit at his baptism, anoint and empower you to reconcile and bless his people. Send down the Holy Spirit on your servant Andy for the office and work of a priest in your church. Through your Spirit, Heavenly Father, give your servants grace and power to proclaim the gospel of your salvation and minister the sacraments of the new covenant. Renew them in holiness and give them wisdom and discipline to work faithfully with those committed to their charge. In union with their fellow servants in Christ, may they reconcile what is divided, heal what is wounded, and restore what is lost. May they declare your blessings to your people. May they proclaim Christ's victory over the powers of darkness and absolve in Christ's name those who turn to him in faith. So shall a people made whole in Christ offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to you, our God and Father, to whom with the Son and the Holy Spirit belong glory and honour, worship and praise, now and forever. Amen. Amen.
God was in Christ,
reconciling the world to himself, and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. We welcome you as an ambassador for Christ. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Bringing before you the bread of life and cup of salvation. but in lives dedicated to the service of Jesus Christ our Lord.